Okay, welcome everyone. Welcome everyone. Okay. I just wanted just to mention something a little bit different, which is we actually have a reporter from the New York Times in the room, which is a little bit different, just waving to us right now, just so you know that they're going to be there. I should also say, remember that this is being streamed on YouTube. Again, I'm just sort of reminding us that, you know, this is, you know, we often sort of feel like we're just us in the room, but actually there may be quite a few people watching. So with that warning ahead, let me give the stage over to Florian.
Thank you very much, Catherine. Thank you very much for everybody for coming. This is a joint work on anonymity and identity online with Paul Goldsmith-Pinkham, who's in the audience, and Kyle Jensen. As I said, this presentation includes numerous excerpts of offensive speech, including racism, sexism, and threats of sexual violence. So I wanted to get that trigger warning out beforehand. Now, what do I want to talk to you about today? It's, I believe, a very important topic for everybody in this room and for everybody in our profession, namely toxic speech in economics. What do economists say when they're anonymous? Why are we interested in that question? We're interested in that question because we think this is indicative of what goes on behind closed doors and in private conversations. We would like to document how widespread is toxic speech in economics. Who engages in such speech? Is it the downtrodden, the disaffected, or is it the elite, or is it just pervasive and everywhere? To that effect, we're going to study the platform Econ Job Market Rumors, or EJMR, which is a popular anonymous message board, which receives millions of monthly visits and many tens of thousands of posts every single month. It is impactful on our profession. It is impactful on the lives and the careers of the people that are being discussed on there. And I believe it is a very worthwhile study to look at who posts on these platforms. Today, what I will be focusing on primarily are the statistical properties of how EJMR allocates usernames and how this reveals IP addresses for the majority of posts on that platform. In that, we're going to focus mostly on the methods of IP address attribution. And then I'm going to show you aggregated variation across posters, across universities, across time, across cities, to show you that there is widespread use of econ job market rumors, even at top universities. And I want to stress here that we only use, and I really stress this, only use publicly available data and follow very much on the seminal work done by Alice Wu in her sequence of papers. Now, for those of you who are not familiar with econ job market rumors, it contains much useful information. It contains information about how to run nonlinear least squares with fixed effects. It contains information on how to make your stata graphs more beautiful. It contains information such as this assistant professor here at a top ranked school asking where one should move down to for the best salaries in terms of lower ranked universities. There's also much gossip, particularly about senior faculty moves. Okay, hundreds of threads about who moves where and who has offers where. Information that clearly can only come from people at top universities sometimes, or sometimes also at universities lower ranked. But there is, and that is, I guess, what econ job market rumors is much more infamous for, much unsavory content on the platform. Racism. Racism right along with ads for Citibank that is placed right below genocidal messages. Economic specific racism. Again, just a line along ads for United Airlines. Sexism and misogyny. Racist and sexist discussion of job market candidates. These posts stay up months, years, without any content moderation. Who writes such things? Racist, sexist, misogynistic posts. I'll show you today that particularly these posts here come from IP addresses at Harvard, at Stanford, at Yale, at Chicago, and even the NBER headquarters at 1050 Mass Ave. Okay, now how does the username allocation on Econ Job Market Rumors work such that we can reveal, or such that it reveals the IP addresses of these posters? Each topic on Econ Job Market Rumors is assigned a topic ID. Okay, it's an auto or an incrementing counter, an auto incrementing counter that's common to WordPress sites. So in this case here, there's the topic, which is right versus left-wing dictatorships, that's called the slug, but it has a specific topic ID, which is 1127272. Each post in a topic is assigned a username, and that username is topic specific. So if I post in this particular thread, in this particular topic here, I get allocated the username 824E. Now that username was characters 10 to 13 of the SHA-1 hash of topic ID and IPv4 address. And for anybody who's familiar with cryptography or online security, this is a allocation scheme that did not use a SALT, which is a random secret that sort of gets added to the stuff that is determinant of the poster. And that was also in plain sight for more than a decade. So I give you an example here. I gave you the example of that username 824E, specific topic ID 1127272 with my IP address. This is an IP address at Yale, okay, which I used to post on there. Showing one input is just topic ID plus the IPv4 address run through a SHA-1 hash, and it gets the output. And then my username is just 824E, okay, characters 10 through 13. Okay. How did we guess this? We guessed this in 15 minutes. The SHA-1 hash is one way. It can't be reversed. So we observe the topic ID, we observe the username, we do not observe the IP address. So how do we go from the usernames and the topic IDs to the IP addresses? Okay. Well, we can just try every possible IPv4 address to see if some of them match. We start with the first IP address, 0.0.0.0, okay? And then we go down all the way to 255555, okay? And some of them, in terms of their SHA-1 output, are gonna match on characters 10 to 13, like my true IP address, okay? 824E. But there are gonna be others that are going to match, okay? Now, how do you do this fast? You need to use graphical processing units, very, very standard, like everybody is basically Bitcoin mining, okay, that's the same thing here. Yeah. You just need to run 3 quadrillion hashes, okay, and you're done. That then returns a set of matching IPs per topic username, about 65,536 in expectation. It's gonna be some randomness around it, but basically when you observe the topic ID and the username, you get a set of matching IP addresses. Okay. Now, that's still a lot of IP addresses. Okay, so let me give you the intuition of how you then go with simple statistics to the true IP address. Okay, so if my IP is this IP here, and I have a first post, which is on the left-hand side, that was the username 824E, I do my hash inversion, which I just told you, this is the hashing, the quadrillion hashes that I do. Then I get a matching set of IPs, okay, for this particular username, for this particular topic, which in this case here is of size 65,668. Okay. If I post from this IP in a different topic, okay, I get a different username. That's the stuff here on the right-hand side. Okay, so my username is now 607E8. I again, after doing the hash inversion, I get a set of matching IP addresses. In this case here, it's 65,907 IP addresses, okay? Which IP address incurs in both sets here? Just one, okay? Because that's the true IP address. And all the other IP addresses are noise IP addresses. They're randomly distributed because of the avalanche property of the SHA-1 hash, okay? Now, This is easy when I know that there are two posts and they're both coming from the same place, okay? How do I do this more generally when I don't know that stuff comes from the same place, okay? And when I have many, many, many more posts and topics, okay? What we can do, probabilistic identification of active IP addresses. So identifying the true IP address is possible because the true IP is always present in that matching set, like I showed you, okay? The other noise IPs are gonna be uniformly ID over the IPv4 space due to the SHA-1 avalanche property. If I change just a tiny bit in the input, it gives me a completely different output. That's the avalanche property. And that leads to this uniform distribution of noise IP. But the true IP, if I count it up, all the possible IPs that I observe, okay, well, in the case before, it showed up twice, okay, and all the other ones just showed up once. Okay. If I do this many, 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 many times across many, many posts, well, the true IPs are gonna show up much, much more often than the noise IPs. Now here, we can then help again get help from the statistical properties. The probability of a noise IP appearing in a topic follows a hypergeometric distribution. Okay? The number of times a noise IP appears in a week or in a time window follows a Poisson binomial distribution. Okay? So let me give you an example of that, what that means. Okay? Let me go with a particular attribution example. Okay? So this is somebody posting in this topic here. Topic ID is 175901. I observe that. I observe the username at 6B42. Okay. Now, let's go and check how we recover now the true IP address for this. We start with 2^32 possible IP addresses. That's the 4.3 billion that had come just from the IPv4 space. The hash inversion narrows it down to 65,385 matching IP addresses for this post here. Now we ask a question. Of those 65,385 IP addresses, how many also explain other topic usernames in a 7-day window? Okay. How many sort of show up in matching sets of other posts around that time? Well, the vast majority, 58,367, never show up in any of them. Okay. 6,627 show up in one of them. Okay. And that's exactly pretty much what we expect by it to happen by chance. Yeah. 378 explain two other ones. Again, what we'd expect by chance. 12, 0, 0, very much what we'd expect to happen by chance. Now, for those of you who are very quick with addition, you'll notice that I've gone up to 65,384 because all the way down here, there's one IP address that explains 103 other topic username sets. Yeah. Now that's very much not expected by chance. Yeah. This is likely the IP address that posted in this particular topic for that post. Now, we do essentially IP attribution as an optimization problem. We find a small set of these active IPs that explain the observed data subject to locality and significance constraint. And this definitely has errors. These are estimable and they're in the paper. The simple intuition of this optimization approach is just that 65,000 IP addresses can explain any given post. One IP is going to explain many other posts in that time window. What is the likely origin IP of this post? It's probably this very highly explanatory IP. Essentially, this is a sparsity argument that the number of users, numbers of possible IPs is much, much smaller than the 4.3 billion possible IP addresses. Okay, now what can we do here? Okay, well, here's another feature that we're exploiting about the hashing. Okay, namely, if we selected a wrong substring of that hash, okay, and said, oh, the usernames must be coming from, say, position 11 to 14 rather than position 10 to 13, then I'd only be getting sets of noise IPs. I would never have the true IP in there. Okay? So when we use that incorrect substring of the hash, that only generates noise IPs. Okay? And then we can run sort of, again, compute the p-values of how likely is it that this showed up just by noise. Okay? And we can do this for the incorrect hash, which is the orange line here. This is the p-value distribution of the Poisson binomial test, the minimum p-value for a particular IP address for a given post. Okay? And you can see the orange line, It's much, much more to the right than the green line, because that green line, that's the correct one. And that has all those minimum p-values, okay, that have IP addresses that attributed to post. Okay? Now we can also use this comparison between these two to determine the p-value thresholds that we're going to be applying. Okay? At what point, at what p-value do we decide, okay, this is probably the IP address, okay, that is assigned to this post. Okay? We're going to assign IPs to posts only if their minimum p-value, okay, is below 10 to the minus 11, okay? It's a lot of stars that you would have in your regression table for that. Okay, now we can do several robustness checks for attribution here. So the first one I told you already is the incorrect hashing set. The other one is bogon addresses. So what are bogon addresses? These are nearly 600 million bogon addresses, which occupy about 14% of the entire IPv4 address space. These bogon addresses can never post to any website, or in particular here to EJMR, but they could be attributed by our process, okay, to posts by mistakes. But our process attributes zero posts to bogon IP addresses for any of the 7.1 million posts that we have in our sample. There's several other robustness checks, but you can check them out on your own time. Now, with these methods, what tools do we get? We get a panel data set linking poster IPs across topics and time. We get a geolocation of these posters, which is high quality at state and country level and can go down to city. It gives you information on ISPs, internet service providers, universities, organizations, corporations, hotels. There are many questions that one can answer with these tools. Okay? The ones we are gonna be focusing on today is, who are the posters on this site? And I'm going to dispel some notions that people might have about, this is just people at lower ranked universities, or this is just graduate students. Okay. And it's not widespread, and the toxicity of the site is very widespread. Okay, let's get into geolocation, which is the simplest thing. Of the 7.1 million posts, okay, we attribute an IP address to 4.7 million posts. Okay. We recover from that 47,630 distinct IP addresses. Now, I want you to bear in mind that these are the most frequent posters. These are only the power posters, okay, that we recover here. There are many, many, many more infrequent posters, and the paper has an estimation of how many IP addresses we believe have ever posted to EconDrop Market Rumors. And then even when you just take the posters, there are gonna be even more viewers, as reflected also by the gigantic monthly visits to this site. Okay. The vast majority of these posts comes from countries with top research institutions in economics and finance, exactly the places where you expect them to come from. The time pattern of posts is that there's been many, many millions of posts since the time that we studied this website. It has an average of 70,000 monthly posts, about 1,100 monthly unique IPs that are being added as of 2022. There's a steady increase of posting volume over time, but there's a very large traffic increase to the website during COVID-19, okay, where you can see that it's primarily driven actually by this blue line, which is off topic and non-econ posts. They're really exploding during that time. Now, what's much more interesting is, okay, where are these posts coming from? Yeah? And not just which countries are they coming from, but which cities are they coming from? The majority of posts come from large cities in the United States, Chicago, New York, Philadelphia. Some fraction also comes from large cities outside the United States, such as Hong Kong, London, Montreal, and Toronto. Perhaps not surprisingly, there are two smaller US cities that show up here with leading research institutions, Cambridge and Berkeley. About 11% of the posts that we attribute with an IP address, okay, originate from IP addresses of universities or research institutions. Okay? I've on the right-hand side here, I give you essentially the research institution share of posts. So get up all the posts from all the various universities, okay, who are the leaders in all of this. Okay? And you can see, as by the parade of colors here, that it is pretty much everywhere. It's in top 25 places. It's in non-top 25 places. It's also at non-universities. Okay? And in fact, posts come from every single R1 institution. Are these the elites of economics that are posting on here? Now, one of the most elite places is presumably this conference. Let's look at the posts that are coming from the Royal Sonesta. There's nothing coming from the Royal Sonesta to EJMR, except when? July 11. That's when it starts. Now, what's taking place on July 11 to July 28th? Yeah? What is not taking place in 2020 and 2021? Speaking of elites, what do these university IPs talk about? Well, they mostly talk about themselves. Okay. As you can see along the diagonal, they talk about themselves a lot. Okay. And they also talk about MIT quite a bit. Now, I want you to remain somber because there is much toxic speech on this platform. Okay. The average IP has 15% of posts that are labeled toxic, hate speech, or misogynistic. There's stuff that would get flagged immediately on all kinds of social network platforms. So it's a very, very high share. And I give you here the sort of the share of attributed posts labeled toxic, hate speech, and misogynistic. Okay, you might say, oh, wait a second. Maybe this isn't just people from non-universities. Okay? Or maybe this is just something else that's happening. Okay? How tolerant, for example, am I to be on this platform, to post on this platform, and to post in topics that also have already a toxic post. Okay? So I can show you that the average IP here has about 54% of posts in topics with at least one post labeled toxic, hate speech, and misogynistic. So people are willing to tolerate toxicity, okay, and still post in the same threads with that same toxicity. This is happening at universities too. So if you compare here, the orange line, which is the average non-university IP that has about 15% of posts labeled toxic or hate speech, the average university IP is a little lower, 13% lower. Is there less tolerance in terms of this being willing to engage in such in being willing to mix with such toxic speech in terms of contributing to topics that already have toxic posts? Okay? Again, it is true that average non-university IPs are somewhat more willing to engage in topics with toxic posts, okay? But the difference is quite small. Now you might say, maybe this is all just driven by lots and lots of power posters or lots of universities that are just very toxic, and that's the ones that are posting on this platform. What I show you here is that this is pretty much everywhere, and the toxicity is pretty much 15%, 10%. Okay, it's not really driven by the volume of posting. Okay? It's not driven by many other factors that you might think explains this. Okay? But this is pervasive. It's everywhere. And I think we should not look away and hope that the problem just goes away. Thank you very much for your time.
All right, everyone. So thank you very, very much to the authors for sharing this paper. What I'm going to be focusing my discussion on is that if you think, I mean, we've heard from Florian, it was a wonderful presentation, very clear. It's very clear how, you know, how he feels about the paper and his commitment to the paper is that he thinks of it as a study of the economics profession, a wake-up call, you know, to sort of say, you know, is this just a few people? Is it a few bad apples? Or is this widespread? Is this pervasive in a way we should be worrying about? And, you know, that's certainly one option for the paper. What I would say about that is, I think, you know, as an option, it naturally leads to a debate about, the need to suppress hate speech and the spillovers it has for our profession, and the, you know, whether or not anonymity allows free speech. And let's be clear, this is a debate with a long and storied history in jurisprudence, right? We're not the first profession to have had this debate. We're not in any ways the first set of people to think about it. So I want to recognize that very natural reaction to the paper. What I'm going to do, though, is because this is about, we're in the digital economics program, is I'm going to be taking a digital economics viewpoint on the paper. And I'm going to be telling you how I think this paper fits into digital economics and where our research agendas may go. And then, you know, as is natural for discussant, I'll do the more normal thing of then suggesting other papers that they should be writing. So, okay. So just because we may have an audience on YouTube, if it hasn't collapsed from too many people viewing it, what is digital economics? What is this program? Well, we have a program where we study changes to how economics works when information is stored in bits rather than atoms. That's what we study. And to place this paper in the history of digital economics, I want to take you through the history of the SHA-1 hash, because it's just got a lot of our discipline in it. You know, first of all, it was released by the NSA in 1995, a very typical product of the innovation process, where the NSA is building on academic research. Obviously, the NSA had a reason for trying to impose secrecy. It worked well for 10 years, but then in 2005, this paper happened, and this was pretty much a bomb, in that three academic researchers basically suggested we were getting close to being able to crack this code. And when I say close, what do I mean by that? Well, they were basically saying, well, you know, how much computing power would we need to be able to crack this? And so what they said was, they said, you know, if you think about it, this is a random problem. It's going to be 2^80. But they managed to find a way, so crack the algorithm to bring it down to 2^69, which is about 2,000 times, and just sort of doing a brute force. And this was at the edge of feasibility in 2005 as a calculation. The estimate was it was just a proof of concept. They didn't really do it. And the estimate was, to do this, you would need a computer that cost $25 million to $38 million. And so that in 2005, probably not commercially viable, but if you're the US government, are you going to be liking the SHA-1 hash anymore? No, you're going to start to be moving away from it, which is exactly what they did, given what this implies. Now, what I want to emphasize is this, is at the time this came out, there was a strong reaction in the security community, and this was one of my favorite quotes, which is basically, okay, this is a theoretical construct, but it's time to walk. We're not running to the fire exit. So the smoke's not there, but the fire alarm has definitely gone off, right? So we knew back in 2005 that the SHA-1 hash was going away. And I would say security community got it right. 2005, you know, it was millions, only really sort of probably possible by, you know, potential enemy states. By 2015, you could do this with a computer that costs $75,000, right? So that's probably not a surprise what happened then, which is that basically the security community had retired this hash for a long time, but basically by the end of 2022, we're not really using it commercially anymore. And so I think we're sort of hearing the story of how the shifts in costs and digital technology, you know, shaped how we might think about security over information. Now, if we go to this paper, you know, obviously if you read the paper, there's a lot of impressive detective work. And just reading it, for me, it sort of echoes something which we see in the economics of information security literature, which just often finds again and again that really it's often not the technology, it's really the humans that are the biggest weakness. And obviously there's sort of two problems here. First of all, there was no attempt at obfuscation. And it's not quite clear why they were using this in the first place. It's sort of, I can't quite describe it. It's a bit sort of like you Googled demand estimation, sort of picture of an ISLM model and then use that for apples. It's all just very, very strange, right? Okay. Anyway, and the other thing which I think made it, without wanting to say down what the authors did, which was clever detective work, in some sense, this wasn't that computationally hard, right? Because we'd reduced it to IP addresses, and that's a lot simpler to do than the sort of free text that all the work in security had done before us. And I think that the authors said that they could do this with an $8,000 computer. My guess is that Yale's paying far too much for computers. Okay. Right, all right. Now, why this is important is because, of course, right? We as a field are facing a world of quantum computing where these kind of calculations, or the kind of calculations we can do, are about to just change in orders of magnitude. And what I really see is when I read this literature and I think about this paper, what we can see is that we're having this fall of costs here, computer power, and it's leading to a shock which was thought to be hidden is really no longer hidden. And so the way I would put this paper in our literature, though I know it's not how the authors think about it, is that it's the first, what I'm going to predict is going to be a large literature over the next 10 years about what happens in our economy when the costs of computing have fallen so much that data we thought was secret is no longer secret. Okay. How long do I have, Abby? Okay. All right. So I've told them how I think about their paper. Now I get to have that job of just trying to say, well, what other things are interesting in terms of, you know, what other things, ways you can, papers you could write for this paper? And for this, we're going to go to think about user attitudes to privacy. And when I'm using the word privacy here, it's sort of strict 1970s Chicago school interpretation, where you're sort of thinking about privacy just being equivalent to secrecy. Now, obviously, there's been a lot of discussion on places like Twitter of this paper. I've sort of seen the screenshots that people have taken of this paper. This is one of the screenshots a lot of people took. It's another way of visualizing some of the results which Florian presented, which sort of saying, you know, what share of posts are really toxic that are coming out from that university? Now, the reason it's interesting to me as a digital economist is just this, is the moment I saw it, I must admit my reaction was, what are these people thinking? And the reason is that historically in the digital economics profession, one of the reasons we got started off is questions around the Digital Millennium Copyright Act. Now, another piece of history, back in 1998, the music industry decides to take on the challenge of Napster. This act got passed, but why it's going to be important for us in 2023 is what it does is basically turns the university into an ISP, which means that as a result, the university is going to be bound to monitor network traffic. In other words, what people are browsing. Now, you know, obviously this has been done because they're wanting to stop students. When that DMCA takedown notice comes, you've got to be able to identify which computer in your network was responsible for the file sharing. But what it means is that for somewhere like MIT, they're actually monitoring what we do. I mean, they just have to, it's sort of by the law. And, you know, for example, you know, even for encrypted traffic, they're gonna be seeing all the domain I'm of the website I'm going to, you know, and they're also, if it was unencrypted, they're gonna know a lot more. So in other words, what's strange to this about me is that, you know, we have people posting toxic messages, at their work in a situation where the work is actually monitoring all their IP addresses, so where they're visiting, the domains they're visiting. So, you know, I was thinking initially, well, you know, is there a paper here which is really about some classic themes, which is the tension between you know, the monitoring implied by our attempts to restrict copyright versus other aims we may have in terms of privacy and anonymity, you know, that may be interesting, it may not be. The other thing I was sort of thinking, which may be sort of more interesting, is this. Is, as I say, this seems sort of like risky behavior. I think we want to, it's quite interesting to understand why people would engage with posting toxic speech in a workplace environment. You know, one thing that struck me in the paper was that the authors spent a lot of time mapping out words or attempts at obfuscation. And the reason they did this is because Econ Job Rumors has a filter, which if you use commonly used swear words or bit word, or words which are highly bigoted, then it deletes your post automatically. And so I was thinking, well, in some senses, maybe it's that people are getting this false sense of security from the fact they're obfuscating their messages. And then is it the case that perhaps this is leading to somehow more risky behavior? And this sort of goes back to another literature, which the economics of information security relies on, which is basically to summarize the idea that sometimes when people are not wearing seatbelts, they drive slower. But if they wear seatbelts, they do drive faster. That's sort of the claim of the literature, though it's much disputed. But is there something here, evidence of this kind of risk compensation, that we're seeing people behave in more risky behavior, for example, engaging in harassment from a university IP with an explicit policy against harassment, you know, both because they're thinking, you know, they're thinking it's Econ Job Rumors and they're, you know, relying on the show on hash, or, you know, because they, and also they're using obfuscating language. And I think this is useful just in case, you know, whether it means that some privacy policies could end up being counterproductive if it actually leads people to distort their behavior and think they're more anonymous than they really are. All right, with that, I'll say thank you and over time.
Okay, thank you. So given time, I think the most efficient thing is just to have Florian and Paul respond, and then there'll be, I'm sure, a lineup of questions. After 5:10, after we adjourn, for them. So, Florian or Paul, who's?
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. No, I'm happy to do it. I was sort of ready to take any questions, but obviously we can talk afterwards. I think, Catherine, again, and thank you to everyone for being on the program, and thank you for everyone for coming. I think it was a really interesting aspect of thinking about, say, we separate out the component in which this was not an economist website, and I think there's two different types of papers one can think about. Certainly, I think one of the, we didn't get a lot of chance to talk about it. I think another interesting aspect, and people have flagged this for us, is when thinking about the types of speech on this site, there's a lot of elements to which the large language models and more generally thinking about this, the cost of that being so much lower, sort of the ability. Yeah.
Okay. Finish your sentence.
Oh, okay.
And then, no. I've been overruled on the, okay, so we're gonna
We've been overruled on the question.
We're gonna go a little long.
I'll finish my sentence. There's a lot of aspects in which the decreasing costs have been interesting, and I agree with Catherine on it. Thank you.
Great. So as we were doing before, line up at the mics, and we'll take about a few minutes of questions.
Yeah, so I think it's important in this discussion to keep the focus on the people who are on the receiving end of the abuse. I think there's a tendency in our field to, this sort of freakonomics phenomenon, everything's an opportunity for an econ paper. I don't think this is it. I think this is a really horrifying and serious result. And I think that, you know, it's not so much about the hyperbolic posts. You know, we all know that happens online. A lot of people can put that aside. But I think what's really the problem is really the microaggressions that we all engage in without perhaps realizing it. And as an economist at the Fed, for 20 years, I've seen a large number of female RAs be turned off on the profession because of the way they were treated. And it's the kind of thing that we don't see, but it's the kind of thing that they see. And my own daughter, in fact, was an econ major at a very strong university I won't name, with a lot of very prominent female role models. And she does not want to be an economist. So, but in terms of methodology, I would recommend looking at microaggressions, because I'm told by younger people that the timing with which you respond to a post is a signal of respect, and that there's actually information there about microaggressions that you might want to use.
Laura.
So I just wanted to comment that, kind of building off of the last commenter's thing, that there are some things that we can do as a profession building off of this research to try to combat this. So one thing that is going on is there is a petition out there that has been signed by almost 1,000 people, possibly 1,000 now after the talk has gone live, that is trying to put forth an organization of people who have had slanderous comments made about them on the website. If you are one of these people or you know someone who has, I really encourage you to look up this petition, sign it, and then also get in contact with Anya Samek at UC San Diego, who is organizing a group of people who might be able to get some consequences for the actions that have been taken against you. So thanks.
Thanks for the research. Very interesting. One of the things that I'm wondering if you could do would be some kind of back of the envelope calculation of maybe an upper bound or lower bound on the number of people. And the reason I'm interested in that is because I actually believe that most people are basically good. It's probably true that my non-econ friends, if I think of them as a community and the econ friends could be less friendly, but not at that order of magnitude. The numbers here seem high. There are about 1,200 econ PhDs that graduate a year. So, you know, with those numbers, but we know these are IP addresses, not individuals. So maybe there's some public data on how many IPs people would typically use within a week and a month, and trying to just create some bounds and see what percent of economists are schmucks. I'm curious about that.
So I'm wondering whether you have, to what extent you see the reverse behavior. So basically a response to a toxic comment that is calling out a toxic comment. And what is the dynamic, and whether it changes the the later dynamic of the particular posting.
Thanks for your paper. This is really, really interesting. And I guess one takeaway it seems to be is that EJMR is different, and that, you know, kind of these ideas of power users and power laws are like not showing up in your data. Is that accurate, or are there places that you do see this power law showing up?
So I'm curious whether you've done any correlations between the institution level statistics you've done and things like the fraction of women in those departments, grad students, faculty. I know the AEA and AFA do annual surveys that I don't think have institutional identifiers. But one thing that came out of the AFA survey was, you know, if there's discriminatory behavior, does your institution do something about it? So I'm just curious to what extent this reflects broader issues.
Two questions. And one, you announced this a while ago on Twitter, and of course there were lots of discussions. I wonder if anything changed, if you observed, if you collected data and saw any changes like on this behavior, because this is about the anonymous nature of, right? Or if your anonymity is gone, perhaps you're less toxic. That's number one. Two, related to that, so let's assume now they received a shock and they are no longer posting on this website, or maybe nowhere online. What else are they doing? I mean, we are not going to change the nature of people, so they are going to start engaging in other behaviors that might be less observable or less detectable. So do we have any concerns about this as well? Thank you.
So also two quick points. One is related to what Steve was talking about. Like, one of the things would be, I think, just for the result on percent of people who post toxic content, helpful to see how this percentage decreases with usage, because that will allow us to project on the infrequent users, and it might be helpful to interpret. And second, this is alone Pinar's questions about, like, this is what, obviously there's a lot of things you can do with this. I'm just curious what next first order things you are planning to do with the data, and I got some questions to answer. Thanks.
I don't have a question. I just want to say thank you.
Okay, Paul. Great. I will be very fast. I know you want me to move quickly. So I'm sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, just one thing that I'm reflecting on here is, you know,
beyond just the individuals who are affected, you know, the cultural issue for the profession that this raises in particular spills over more broadly, because it kind of creates a culture of distrust when everybody's kind of wondering, you know, who, for example, in the room might have been in the data set, right? And so, like, thinking about, I don't know if there's a way to, you know, execute on this in some way in the work, but thinking about like what some of those broader repercussions might be too is also interesting in my view. So yeah, take it away.
Great. Yes, I know that we want to be quick. So let me just kind of quickly go through ideas, and I think there's some empirical suggestions. I'm going to go back and forth. So there's this question that about going the back and forth and thinking about the ordering within the post. I think a little bit of that is actually related to work that Alice Wu did, of course, thinking about the how the post transition, which haven't done that yet. And you saw one version of that where we're kind of thinking of, do you post in a topic that looks like this? But there's much more. We know exactly kind of when the post happened, very doable. And I think we have to kind of think about how to structure the question. In terms of thinking about the number of people and the number of IPs, just the short answer is, I think it's a good statistics problem. The one way you could start to think about it is there's a number that Florian presented, which was about 1,100 average monthly users. I think the more that you winnow it down, you're obviously not going to be getting everyone, but you could start to talk about a rate of people who are posting, like the relative share, right? We go down to about 1,000 in a month versus we have many, many more thousands over the longer horizon. So there's a caveat to that, that some places like Sonesta, if you post here, it's all one IP that faces outward. And so that's gonna go in the wrong direction, unfortunately. The power law and thinking about this, I would say that much of our results looks very similar to other online platforms. Certainly the distribution of posts, we have a very nice thing that looks at who's the kind of the top, the most frequent poster, kind of looks people who use Twitter. I'm one of them, you know, I post a lot. There are people who post much less. It's kind of this same similar power law distribution. It looks very similar to these online sites. One comment I actually make, I don't have a good statistic yet to kind of describe this is about substitution. You know, the job market posting, certainly when I was a graduate student, the way that I knew about this site was like when I was on the job market and wanting to know something, you think of things going up starting in October and maybe peaking in January and December, you want to know when job offers, and then maybe falling off. You could think there's a seasonality. What's kind of striking about the site in terms of posts over time is really what happens is like the job market stuff goes up in the winter and then it falls off. And there's just like pretty much substitution into the other kinds of conversations that people who use this site are addicted. They're addicted to the platform is what it seems like. I mean, that's a strong statement. That's not a mental health diagnosis, but you continue to the same way that I am addicted to Twitter in the sense that I continue to use it even in times when sort of I don't need to professionally or otherwise. The demographic question I think John maybe asked was this, we've started to do it. I think actually we want to get the AA data. With my work with Anusha Chari, we've had a snapshot in 2020 of kind of demographic, both race, ethnicity, and gender of the top 25 universities at the business schools and at the university level. We started to try to map that over and look at some of the cross-sections. The problem is it's a relatively small number of institutions and we didn't find much there. I think one interesting fact that I think is consistent with this is that if you look at the number of faculty, one question that people have asked us, for example, is like, well, there's just a lot of faculty there. You know, places that have many faculty, that's what it's gonna be, or many grad students. There's a weak relationship between that. The places that have a lot more faculty, there does seem to be a little bit more, but we're not talking like that's not explaining most of the variety, which suggests, I think to Steve's question, it is gonna be a subset of people who read it, who are posting. And so maybe that because they're relatively small, that's not gonna correlate too much with the size of the institution because the relative distribution is not large. One comment I do wanna make, and this reflects to some of this, is that it's just like, mind-boggling. If you think about, I mean, this was in the first slide, remember, this is a website that has millions of viewers every month. You know, when we've been working on this, unfortunately, we've had to read the website a lot. We contribute to some of it, but like, this is a site that lots of people go read, and the subset of people that we're analyzing is just the posters, and there's like a 100-to-1 effectively relationship between the two. So even if you're, you know, the people who are not posting, so this is not, if you want to think it's a small subset, I was telling you it's a small share of faculty, but lots of people read it. And so I think that's another important aspect to keep in mind. I'm sorry if I missed anyone's questions, and feel free to come grab us for any questions you have afterwards. They've changed the hash. We actually don't have no idea, but so yeah, certainly right now the cryptographic, you know, we actually have posted some videos explaining what's going on and we have more detail on this, but right now sort of the procedure that we use as of when the abstract was posted, sort of soon after, the username is still the same. It's still a four hexadecimal username, but it's not going to follow. Yes, if you try to replicate our paper currently with exactly what's there, we have some documentation online where we're discussing this. There's archived versions of the website, et cetera. We can talk about this offline if you're interested. Thank you very much for all your time and all your questions.
Thank you.